Thank you, Ms. Kim, for that long introduction. Yeah, and because I think it was highlighted in the introduction that we did a project coordinated by CIRCA on climate change vulnerability assessment and adaptation identification. I think some of you might be anticipating that my center paper will be on that project. That will not be so because this is it's like it's related to it but not related to it. No, it's not all about the project. That project is done, and we had a series of seminars, no, here and in the communities already. No? And if you're interested, CIRCA has all the repository of the materials, no, that were generated during the project. My seminar paper today is a more personal matter. Let me contextualize where I'm coming from. I'm doing my PhD by research in environmental science, and in that regard, may I thank Dr. Lansigan, who is part of my advisory committee, who took time to be here. Huwag niyo lang po ako sasakalin pag ano. But this is part of the requirement, no, towards the degree, and it's just part and parcel of a big chunk of work that I have started. No? This is really part of the review of literature, no, that I'm doing towards coming up with a nested methodology for vulnerability assessment that will center an indicator system, no, within that methodology. So the title that we have suggested is towards clarification of definitions, methodologies, and approaches, a state of the art of climate change vulnerability assessment. No? But you know, there's this material in one of the seminal papers that I have been looking into, saying that when you go into a study on what is there in terms of vulnerability assessment, what you will encounter is a Tower of Babel. No? So the more you know, the more you don't know. The more you read, the more confused you become. No? And I think that is exactly what I have been experiencing for the last two semesters. No? Reading all of these articles and literature on vulnerability assessment. So, while I was pondering on this PowerPoint, I was telling myself, parang hindi state of the art, eh, parang it's more patches and holes, no, that I have with me. So that's my first disclaimer. No? My apologies if you don't learn anything new, no? But I did learn a lot while going through all of these materials, including the patients, no, with the sleepless nights. No? What if you are supposed to review like not less than 1,500 just through the search engine of UPLB, and that's just a search engine of UPLB. So this is really just scratching the surface, no, with regards to the literature, no, the voluminous literature that is out there. No? So that's the context of my paper. Maybe I would be gaining more from your comments, no, and if there are things that you'd want to share, I would really appreciate that. afterwards. So the objectives of this paper, let me discuss first what it is not. Just in case you are assuming that it will prescribe definitions, it will not. No? With all the definitions that I have encountered in the literature, I did not even have a section here that will outline all of those definitions. Instead, what I will have here would be the methodological underpinnings behind those definitions. So this is meant to provide an organization of representative literature to enable me and the reader of my paper a better understanding of the roots of assessment methods, discuss the conceptual frameworks useful in the conduct of vulnerability studies, and hopefully identify possible gaps in vulnerability research that can be addressed by future research in vulnerability and vulnerability assessment. So this is the outline of my paper. So there's a brief introduction in the paper looking into some of the justification for a paper on vulnerability and vulnerability assessment. And then a section on understanding vulnerability. So part of that will be to look into what are the requisites, what are the minimum elements that's supposed to be there before we can talk, we can speak of researching in the field of vulnerability. And then the different interpretations of vulnerability. One would be to look into the difference in how do we account for vulnerability? Do we take it from a starting point or as an end point? There's also discussion by O'Brien and her colleagues on the difference between outcome and contextual vulnerability. From a more methodological point of view, and when I say methodological, that will encompass epistemological underpinnings, not just the methods and the tools. What are the existing dominant framing of climate change phenomenon, and a little on vulnerability factors supposed to guide me in identifying my from a deductive argument some of the indicators. And then approaches to vulnerability research, a section on approaches to vulnerability assessment, and then some words on gaps and issues. Okay, so many of the literature have contended that before we can talk about vulnerability and researching vulnerability, there are at least four elements that need to be clarified, that need to be there. One is what is that system that you're going to analyze in terms of vulnerability, and this can come in a variety of scales. We did a project on vulnerability assessment that took on at least two scales. No? One is at the household level as a unit of analysis, and the other is the barangay level as a unit of analysis. And you come up with different tools and different ways of different indicators for those two systems. So what is the system of analysis? What is the characteristic of that system that you are interested about and you're concerned about in terms of vulnerability? And then the external part is, what is the hazard that we are talking about? So is this vulnerability to flooding, vulnerability to the variability in climate parameters, is this vulnerability to sea level rise, to storm surges, no? Or in a more, from the more social part of the literature, there are vulnerability studies looking into vulnerability to poverty and the lack, no? And then another element is the temporal reference, no? The system part, no, the unit part will already cover part of the spatial requisite, no, of vulnerability research, no? But the literature were also clear, no, in saying that vulnerability research must also be clear regarding its or their temporal reference. Okay, so there are a number of they're not really mutually exclusive types of interpretations, no? But we can ideally put some of them in a continuum, no? So there are these interpretations of vulnerability. One is we can actually look at vulnerability as a starting point, or are we doing that? Is that clear in our research? Or are we talking about vulnerability as an outcome? What is the difference, no, between the two? So literature is saying that there are researches that are explicit, no, in identifying that they're coming from a starting point of view. And there are those researches that are coming from vulnerability as an endpoint. No? This is a material from Fassel, no? Published in 2007. No? Differentiating, can you see at the back? It's small, but I did not have the energy to input it myself, so I just got it from the material. So comparing endpoint and starting point interpretations of vulnerability in terms of certain characteristics. No? For instance, in terms of root problem, when they're starting from an endpoint interpretation, the root problem really is climate change. Okay? And so climate change is the root problem, vulnerability is the end product. Okay? From a starting point interpretation, the definition of vulnerability, the understanding of vulnerability is that it is the root problem. So you're starting with vulnerability itself, not climate change. Now, this has implications not only on methodology, not only in terms of indicators, no, that you're going to develop, no, this has also policy implications later on. No? The policy context kasi is when it is an endpoint interpretation, you look at vulnerability at the end, no, of the line. But you have climate change and you do vulnerability assessment, where do you situate, where do you locate vulnerability? From a policy context, no, the endpoint interpretation is that we need to mitigate, no, in terms of what's causing climate change. Because if the end part is vulnerability, to reduce vulnerability, then you will need to mitigate, no, the causes, no, of those vulnerabilities. No? So this will point to climate change mitigation, compensation of countries, no, that are affected by climate change and variability. And if there's a discussion about adaptation, usually this has more to do with technical adaptation and mitigation activities. Whereas if it's a starting point interpretation, because you're starting with vulnerability itself, the policy context is how do we reduce vulnerability at the onset because there's vulnerability already at the onset, and maybe that's just aggravated by climate change. So there's much more focus of policy in terms of social adaptation and sustainable development. So we have here illustrative policy questions. If it's an endpoint interpretation of vulnerability, an illustrative question would be, what are the benefits of climate change mitigation? Whereas from a starting point interpretation, you ask how can vulnerability of societies or sectors in societies be reduced, no? Given climatic hazards. No? So that's a policy question. In terms of a research question, endpoint interpretation will point to questions like, what are the expected net impacts of climate change in different regions? Whereas a starting point interpretation, an example of a research question would be, what are the groups that are vulnerable and why are they vulnerable? Why are some groups more vulnerable, more affected by climatic hazards compared to other sectors? No? So this is something new because when we frame our research questions, we usually do not think anymore and we do not reflect anymore as to how do we really interpret vulnerability. In terms of its relationship with adaptive capacity, when it is an endpoint interpretation, adaptive capacity determines vulnerability. No? Whereas from a starting point interpretation, vulnerability determines adaptive capacity. Okay? So both interpretation will have reference for adaptation and adaptive capacity. But from an endpoint view, adaptation is seen as adaptation to future scenarios, no, of climate change. Whereas for a starting point, you're talking about current vulnerability, and so you're talking about how do we adapt, no, to current climate variability. So the starting point of the analysis of researches when it is endpoint interpretation would be the scenario of future climatic hazards. Whereas the starting point of the analysis for a starting point interpretation would be the current vulnerability, no, of a particular sector, a particular group to climatic stimuli. No? In terms of how analysis goes, no, in the research process, no, the endpoint interpretation, which is, by the way, most of them are really the hard natural scientists, the mathematical part, the hydrology part, the engineering part, no? They're more descriptive and positivist in approach. The analytical function for starting point interpretation will be more explanatory. Why people are more vulnerable than others and normative in nature. So in terms of main disciplines, ayan, nakita natin, marami sa natural sciences endpoint ang kanilang perspective, whereas the starting point for the starting point interpretation is dominated by social science disciplines. No? In terms of what they really mean when they say vulnerability, when they speak of vulnerability, endpoint perspective looks at vulnerability as expected net damage for a given level of climate change. No? Whereas for starting point interpretation, vulnerability really speaks of the susceptibility to climate change as determined by certain factors, no? Socioeconomic or otherwise. No? So the vulnerability approach, let me bring you there, vulnerability approach for endpoint interpretation is usually we talk a lot about risk, no? Whereas the vulnerability approach, no, the conceptual approach is more of a political economy in the starting point, because the focus there are really people, no, and human systems. So there's an indicative reference there, no, so that you know that when you encounter the IPCC, no, McCarthy is main author, major author, IPCC is really dominated by the outcome interpretation of vulnerability. We're talking about the TAR, the TAR, the third assessment report, as well as the AR4. No? Kailan ba, sir, lalabas ang AR5? No?
This week.
This week na. Ay, hindi ko pa po siya nakikita, no? But I got hold of a book. It's a special report of the group 1 and group 2 of IPCC. And I read there that these are also the people in that book, no? Are also the ones going to be really responsible for AR5, no? And I was looking at their definitions and how they interpret vulnerability and risk. There are significant changes, so much so that there's a lot of embracing on the part of IPCC now of the disaster risk reduction tradition. No? Kasi may dalawang tradition pa yan, yung climate change group, no? Yung climate change community, and DRR community. And there is this bibliometric analysis by Janssen, no, looking at different communities. Do they really share literature and citations? No? And surprisingly, there's very, very little, no, cross-cutting of literature. So the tendency is for people in a particular community to share, no, within and among themselves. Although it's not entirely absolute, no, na wala cross-cutting citations. So that is if you want to interpret, you want to look into the interpretation of of vulnerability as either endpoint or starting point. Okay. Karen O'Brien and her colleagues, no, have a different mixing, no, of the literature that they reviewed, and they talk about the difference between outcome vulnerability versus contextual vulnerability, no. When we say outcome vulnerability, this is almost the same as endpoint, no? Wherein you start with climate change, so there is that variable, climate change. You talk of the exposed system, whether it's the household, your community, etc. What are the responses? And given you subtract the response from the sensitivity and the exposure, and you have their vulnerability. So vulnerability as an outcome, no, as a result, no, of climate change. Contextual vulnerability centralizes people, no, the social and the human. So what they're saying is that vulnerability, no, is within a context that includes a lot of other factors aside, no, from climate change and variability. So what climate change and variability contributes to this contextual vulnerability, no, would be together with maybe aggravate, no, the vulnerability of your system, no, or your sector, because there are also other external factors affecting their vulnerability that will include political and institutional structures and changes, as well as the economic and social structure. But then there's also the internal context, no, of these people, their biophysical context, their technological environment, their socioeconomic environment, and their institutional context. And you have response there below. No? How they would respond would be also a matter of all of these factors. So is it clear? Am I contributing to clarifying these interpretations? Okay. Okay, so that's from O'Brien. Okay. And this one looks into the discourses on environmental change and their relationships in terms of framing one of the phenomena, which is climate change. No? So the discourse accordingly falls under three major categories. No? One would be the more biophysical positivist, no, frame. Another would be the more critical Makibaka frame, no? And a third would be more of the human ecological frame, no? Or where central to their research and their framing of climate change is really the human environment relationship. No? There are a lot of literature now trying to push for a couple socio-economic, socio-ecological system as the unit of analysis, no, in climate change research. Kasi pag more biophysical, ang tendency niya nahihiwalay yung social system sa natural at saka sa biological system. Okay, so the description of the biophysical frame is that it takes the Earth system as a starting point and focuses on what humans are doing to the biological and physical conditions and processes of this Earth ecosystem. No? So ano ang effect, ano yung impact ng tao? No? Tayo ang may kasalanan kasi kaya may climate change, no? And all. No? And it reflects the Enlightenment paradigm of positivist science, which is based on an understanding that more information and knowledge will enable society to better manage environmental problems. So in that regard, from a biophysical and positivist discourse, climate change as a phenomenon is really seen as a scientific and very academic issue. No? And that it requires studying, it requires research for us to better understand the key processes and as well as the impacts, no, of human activities on these processes and systems. Okay, so that's biophysical. Critical, these are just labels, by the way, no, in the attempt to put labels on the different philosophical and theoretical and epistemological ways of interpreting the phenomenon. Critical discourse or critical frame, no, is when you emphasize the social and political relations shape processes, responses, and outcomes from environmental change. They reflect more on social theory and post-structuralist as well as post-modernist paradigms, no? And many proponents question they're very, very critical. Kaya nga tinawag siya critical, no? They're very, very critical of the scientific paradigm and the kind of hegemonic power it has, no, on society, no? And there's the centrality of biophysical and human environment discourse, and it draws a lot from the works of philosophers and postmodern theorists, and proponents argue that scientific inquiry, theories and hypotheses represent social constructions of reality, you know, that are influenced by history and as well as current situations. You know? And so, when that is the framing, what is climate change? You know? How do they really regard climate change? It is a human security issue that requires understanding, you know, of differential capacities of people to respond to changing environmental conditions. Okay? The human environment or the human ecology discourse, you know, situates all of these environmental changes within the context of the relationship, the interrelatedness, you know, of human and natural systems, where the natural environment is seen, you know, as inseparable, you know, when inseparable from human activities. So it draws upon references to coupled human environment systems, SES, you know, the work on resilience. There is such a thing as a resilience alliance, you know, as well as adaptive management. You know. And nature-society interactions are considered to operate at multiple scales and interact with multiple stressors. So climate change the discourse about climate change is that it will refer to both biophysical, the more scientific and the more human security oriented framing, but emphasizing that, hey, science has a role here in promoting sustainability. Okay, so O'Brien has this tool for identifying interpretations of vulnerability. So this is very useful if you have a huge set of materials and you want to know, itong author na ito, ano bang pinanggagalingan niya? Ano bang diskurso niya? Itong author na ito, bakit ganyan ang kanyang definition, no, ng vulnerability? Bakit ganyan ang decision niya in terms of how to conduct vulnerability assessment? So, O'Brien and her colleagues came up with this diagnostic tool, looking at first what kind of representative questions, the focal points of the research, the methods being used in the research, and then what kind of identified results are emphasized, and then what are the policy recommendations of the studies. No? So given this elements, you can gauge whether a particular research study is coming from an outcome or a contextual interpretation of vulnerability. No? So, research question. Pag ganyan ang research question mo, are human activities contributing to dangerous levels of climate change? So that is the kind of research question wherein you're actually coming from vulnerability as an outcome, no, type. No? So this one is in the literature. Let me just go on. This will be available with this kit. Okay. In doing vulnerability research and analysis, Fassel also suggests that we should look at the minimal categories of factors, no, when researching vulnerability. The reason for a lot of confusion and Babylonian confusion, accordingly, no, is that there are a lot of things that we really take for granted and we fail, no, to consider, no, and emphasize in the process of research. So according to Fassel, there are two spheres or major scales, no, where vulnerability can be study, no? There's the internal factors, no? There's the internal sphere, and there's the external sphere. Internal would be those characterizing the system as within, and external would be taking into consideration factors, no, that are impinging upon the system but are actually external to it, no? And also considering the knowledge domain, no, which has something to do with the discourse categories, no? So dalawa lang yung tiningnan ni Fassel, no? Is it more socio-economic in terms of the kind of domain, or is it biophysical? And so there are indicative types of research, no, that goes into the combination of, for instance, it is looking into the internal sphere from a more sociological and more social science perspective. So there's a focus on household income, there's a focus on social capital, access to information, and the like. Whereas if it's a more biologic, biophysical discourse, internal, you look at topography, you look at environmental conditions, you look at the more biophysical components, no? Including land cover. External, we're talking more of national policies, international aid, no? The whole process of globalization as external factors, and the socio-economic tradition would be focusing on this, whereas the more biophysical processes, no, external to the system would be under the the combination of biophysical and external. So again, what Fassel did was to point this out and use this system, no, to identify, the different types of researches in terms of focus. Okay, and earlier we did a rundown of the requisites, no, before we can talk, before we can embark on vulnerability research, no. Fassel did a review of that, no, and came up with these dimensions of vulnerability that has to be taken into consideration there. The hazard is still there, the attribute of concern is still there, what is the vulnerable system that we're talking about is still there, but he added the temporal part, no, the time issue is still there, whether it's current or future, or we're talking of something really dynamic. But he added the sphere, no, whether it's internal, external, or cross-cutting, and knowledge domains, no, whether it's socio-economic or biophysical, or it's an integrated type, no, of research. Okay. So that's from Ikin and Lewers came up with a summary of the lineage, no, the group, no, of vulnerability studies. And again, there are elements for comparing the different material, no? But he talked about three conceptual lineages. Ito yung mga scholarly communities, no? So there's a community of scientists that are really, all of them are talking about vulnerability, they study vulnerability, but some of them belong to the risk hazard community. And one time I got confused, no? This was, I think, two semesters ago when I took this course under Dr. Lansigan. I was coming from, you know, vulnerability being the function of exposure, sensitivity, and adaptive capacity. And I did not figure out where the risk term, no, comes in, parang it's a taken for granted thing to me. And in the class, it was mentioned that vulnerability is just part of risk, no? That risk is actually the product of exposure and vulnerability. So, magkaibang, ano yun, parang magkaibang equation, no? And that has implications, again, if you're talking indicators, that would have implications on the indicators and how you're going, are you going to add, are you going to multiply, no? Which is which? Is vulnerability a part of risk, or is risk a part of vulnerability? Yung mga ganon, no? So there's a risk hazard community. There's the political economy community, which actually discourse, in terms of discourses, they're more critical, no? And then there is this growing body of knowledge on resilience science, no? So the focal questions are there. If the kind of questions would be, what are the hazards? What are the impacts of hazards? Where is the hazard? When will it occur? No? So this is more of the risk hazard type of research. No? Whereas if, again, you're looking at systems, you're talking at underlying processes and control, how to control the ability, in terms of control and ability to cope, no, and adapt, that may be more of ecological resilience tradition. Okay. Let me say first that while we are looking at all of these classifications, no, they're not, they're not as if carved on stone. Na pag may risk, pag sa research mo, you're talking about risk, you're a risk hazard scientist. No? It's not that. It's just that there are dominant characteristics. So in terms of what are the key attributes, the key attributes that are examined by the risk hazard community would be exposure and sensitivity. For the political economist and the political ecologist, they're more into ano, capacity ng system, ng tao, sensitivity and exposure. For resiliency studies, there's the threshold of change, reorganization, and the capacity to learn and adapt as an issue in resiliency. Exposure unit, we see also that may kanya-kanya silang biases, no? The risk hazard, most of the time, the researchers will have places, sectors, activities, landscapes, or regions as their exposure unit. Those that study at the individual, the household level, very specific livelihoods, they're more the political ecology tradition. And coupled human environment systems, no, is really had been adapted, no, by the growing community on resilience. This decision scale of assessment, regional and global for risk hazard, local, regional, as well as global for the political economy, and landscape, ecoregions, and multiple scales, coupled human environment systems for the resiliency group, no? We put in there some selected definitions also, so we'll have an idea how do we really define vulnerability, no, from there. And so there is no right or wrong definition here. It's just really a matter of your definition being the product of some underlying, you know, discourses and interpretations, which will now affect the kind of method, you know, and the tools that you're going to use. That's from Ikin and Lewis. Okay. This one is almost the same, the risk hazard, the political economy. There are the hybrids, no? Pressure and release model, and integrated approaches, no? And this is using the vulnerability factors that was developed by, that was suggested by Fassel, no? So risk hazard would be more internal and biological, no? That's what they would look into, and so on and so forth, no? So and you see some cross-cutting there, and some where the author, the reviewer, no, is not very sure if there's a part that's being focused on that given this particular approach. Okay, Hinkle, another author of a seminal paper, no, was saying that vulnerability assessment actually is rooted on the earlier, no, impact assessments, no, of climate change, no. So before they were not talking vulnerability assessment yet, they were talking about the impact, no, assessment of climate change and climate variability. And the focus of all of those impact assessment, if you will notice, would be to look into the reason for vulnerability, no? The reason for the study. What are our concentration levels? So what's the emission part? What are these things causing or have caused, no? Climate change, no? So climate change as a result of those emission and concentrations, and that in part will now result to certain exposures, the sensitivity, and what are the impacts therefore. There's also the centrality of mitigation, okay, in impact assessment. From there, okay, the first generation vulnerability assessments, no, put in more factors, no? So one would be one of the more significant there would be, aside from climate change factors, they put in into the picture when they do the assessment, no, some non-climatic, perhaps social, political, and economic factors, no, and they're not just talking of impacts now, but rather that given the exposure, the sensitivity, and the impact of this, no, what now is the level of vulnerability, and based on that, we're supposed to do adaptation, still a little of mitigation. So these are usually the concepts that they use, no, in first generation vulnerability assessments. Okay, the more recent vulnerability assessments, no, have put in the centrality of adaptive capacity into the picture. Okay. After this, there's the growing of the adaptation and adaptive capacity community, where many studies are now focusing on adaptation and adaptive capacity, looking into and evaluating adaptation options, no? Especially from economics, no? So iba naman yon, adaptation policy group naman yon. Okay, so vulnerability is not the same as vulnerability assessment. What we have done so far is saying that before we embark on vulnerability assessment or the study of vulnerability, we have to be clear, no, about our interpretations. No, we have to be clear because this has impacts, this has implications on the kind of methods that we're going to decide on. No, and if you're going to do an indicator system, which I'm trying to do, no, then there's the baggage of how do I generate this indicators, for instance. Assessment methods fall into very general research methods. There are descriptive types of assessments. There are highly qualitative types of narrative, case studies, type of vulnerability studies. In our recent project, no, we did quali and quanti, no, side by side. We had our colleague from economics doing vulnerability assessment of households, no, using an indicator approach and comparing that to the use of VEP or vulnerability as expected poverty, so looking at an expenditure as and the falling below poverty threshold as an indicator, no, of vulnerability. We had a colleague from the College of Engineering doing the mapping portion, and of course, the likes of me have to ensure that they do not only map forest cover, they also map, we have to map also some socioeconomic variables that can be spatially represented, no? So that we have the whole menu, no, of variables, no, contributing, no, to vulnerability taken into consideration. We have models, no, we have researchers that either have tested models, testing models, and some are trying to come up with new models, no? I came across this article by Ionescu for the mathematically challenge me, no? There were no numbers, but you know, Ionescu and his colleagues, they were trying to come up with a formalization of vulnerability, and they said that with all of this confusion, you should come up with something that will unite everyone. And so the only way to do that is through writing it in mathematical form that is going to be acceptable to all the communities, whether you are coming from resilience group, you're coming from a more critical perspective, etc. No, so I was really challenged, no? Looking at all the symbols and the equations, no? And the indicator approach, no, is just one, but it is it continues to be a very relevant assessment method and tool, because for one, it tries to make a lot of complex things simple. No? There's a lot of challenges, but there's continuing work, no, in vulnerability literature that's doing indicator-based studies. Okay, the difficulties, no, according to Hinkel, is that when you do an indicator study, or an indicator, we use an indicator approach, no? One, there is there is no clear convergence, no, between definitions, no, theoretical definitions and reality, and many of the concepts, even those that are used, no, in the IPCC literature, no, according to Hinkel, they tend to be vague and they are difficult to operationalize, no? And there is also the lack of clarity on how the defining concepts are to be combined, no? Ito yung sinasabi ko kanina na how do you really combine risk, exposure, vulnerability, adaptive capacity, which comes under which, no? And there are a lot of other intricacies, no? Sub-intricacies. For instance, when they talk about resilience, there's a group of scientists, they look at resilience as an antonym. It's the flip side of vulnerability. What they're saying is that you reduce vulnerability, you're actually increasing resilience, no? But there's also a group of scientists, no, saying that they're not antonyms, no, of one another. Albeit resilience is just an element that can be subsumed under vulnerability. Yung ganun ba? No? So there's confusion, and these are the difficulties that make the indicator approach also challenging. Of course, if you don't deal with these things and you just go into it, you know, trying to come up with what are the indicators according to studies that have been done, and I just take it from there, there's not much difficulty there, no? But one of the observation also of those who reviewed articles and studies and researches is that there are very, very few studies which are clear about their philosophical and epistemological basis for their study. They come up with all sorts of decisions in the research without being clear about their interpretation of and their location of vulnerability. Okay, and then there are issues about measurement. When we say measurement, I think one of the more understandable definition is that measurement refers to the systematic process of assigning a number, no, to a particular phenomenon. No? So it's like you want to measure the change in the variables of climate, so maybe you can measure differentials in heat. No? The question there when you're talking about vulnerability is, can you really measure vulnerability? Is it something that you can see, you can hold, is it something that you can measure with your measuring stick? No? So what Hinkel was saying is that it might be, in fact, even impossible to measure vulnerability because it is just a theoretical concept. So instead of measuring vulnerability with your indicators, no, and an index, maybe it's more accurate to speak about making it operational instead of measuring it. So you come up with indicating variables, no, which you can measure, no, in view of vulnerability really as a concept. Okay. And so what are the steps that we go through, no, generically in developing indicators, no? Hinkel suggests that there are three main steps. One is, first you have to define what is to be indicated. No? So in this case, we're talking about vulnerability. And then you select the indicating variables and you come up with a indicator function. So these are very general steps. No? Stroker, Polsky, and Pack, on the other hand, came up with an 8-step method for vulnerability assessment. No? And here you see that they're incorporating the more participatory approach, no? Which, by the way, we did, no? For our project. There were a lot of fighting and shouting and bad feelings when you have all sorts of scientists and experts coming together from different fields and from different countries, no, trying to agree about what indicators are we going to use across countries. No? So, iba-iba, parang ang hirap, but there are a lot of insights and lessons for us, and we're appreciative of that. No? So define the study area together with your stakeholders, so very participatory. Get to know the place through review of literature, gain formal interviews and the like, but you have to get to know the place. No? So this is really guiding me, no, in all these efforts that I'm doing. Hypothesize who is vulnerable and to what they are vulnerable. Develop a causal model of vulnerability. Then you find, you come up with your indicators for the elements of your vulnerability, but you have to make sure first what kind of other concepts you have to put into the equation. If you're including adaptive capacity, so what are your indicators for adaptive capacity? When you say sensitivity, what is your definition of sensitivity, and what are your indicators? And they talk about different ways, deductive, inductive, and normative ways, no, of generating, no, the indicators. Then you operationalize the models of vulnerability, project future vulnerability, and at the end, what Scroter and his colleagues are saying, you should also communicate vulnerability in a very creative manner, no? Emphasis, creative. Because in our experience, it is true, when you're talking about local communities and local government units, tayo, sometimes we get a high talking about vulnerability, climate change scenarios, and all that stuff. Sila simple lang, ang kailangan lang nila, no? Kailangan nilang mapunuan yung mga plano nila, yung kanilang CLUPs, yung kanilang development plans, no? And that's about it. And whatever research you generate, sometimes either they don't exert effort anymore, no, to absorb, no, the science in it, no. They would rather hire you, no, to do the science part basta sa kanila. What are your recommendations? And that's about it. So if we want to mainstream science-based and knowledge-based actions and activities as a response to changing climate, and we're not in the ones in the decision-making arena, people from the academy and from the science community, I think that should be a challenge, how to communicate vulnerability research, you know, and climate change research for that matter. Okay, so in developing indicators, okay, there are two major challenges that Hinkle suggests. One is the challenge of defining the vulnerable entity. How do you put the boundary, especially when you're using a coupled human-environment system, no? How do you define, no, the boundaries of your system? And there is also the challenge of the forward-looking aspect of vulnerability. Vulnerability is supposed to look into future vulnerabilities, but how do you do that if the kind of measurement or the kind of indicating variables that you're using are really just giving you contextual and current vulnerability? That's where all the modeling comes in. And the other issue there is how do you come up, how do you develop your vulnerability indicators? There are three major arguments here. One is deductive ways and arguments in developing vulnerability indicators. So when you say deductive, it's based on what is there in the review of literature, expert judgment, no? And this is the type that was used in the indicator assessment that Blakey, for instance, and Smith did, no? And which was elaborated later on by Jorge and Toy. And then there's the inductive type, no? Which generates the indicators from the data, no? And the analysis of the data. An example of this was the one done by Brooks, no? Where he first came up with a number, a big number, or I think almost 50 indicators, no, using the deductive argument, and then he reduced this eventually to 11 vulnerability indicators by using mortality as a harm indicator. So out of the 46 yata or 47 indicators, what will correlate with mortality, and he came up with 11, and that's the final set of indicators that he had. So it's out of the data, no? So inductive, okay? Normative arguments is when you use, or when you come up with your indicators using collective or individual value judgment in the selection and aggregation of your indicating variables, no? You use your own personal value judgment to talk with another expert and what the other people in your community, in your scientific community are saying also, and you test and put in all of those indicating variables. The other utility of the normative argument is on weight assignment, no? Because one of the issues in the indicator system is when you use indicating variables, no, to indicate levels of vulnerability, do you assign equal weights, no, to these indicators? Or is there a way of a more objective way of assigning weights, no? So there are certain tools that can be used, like the analytical hierarchy procedure, the AHP, no, as a tool in to aid you in assigning weights, no? I was talking to an economist the other day, no? And we were talking about VEP, no? Vulnerability as Expected Poverty. And because in our project, the economist in our team was saying, what's exciting about the VEP is that you don't have the pressure of assigning weights. No? We don't talk about weighting, because it's a very inductive process. What the data says when you run the regression analysis, that's about it. No? But here is this other economist saying that actually the VEP procedure, no, or the VEP approach also makes use of weights, but the weights, you don't do it normatively, but inductively. So the weights are those that you generate after you run your regression analysis. So walang bias. Okay, so those are ways of developing vulnerability indicators. Some other issues that may be important to consider when talking about vulnerability assessment and using specifically an indicator approach would be, have we really thought about, according to Inkel, have we really thought about why we are doing this? No? Is it fit, no, for the purposes that they are meant, no, to achieve? No? In vulnerability assessment and vulnerability research, basically what we're saying is that we want to have an idea of vulnerability to guide us in terms of policy and to guide us in terms of adaptation. No? So there are certain questions, according to Hickel, we pose these questions to see if when you do vulnerability assessment, is it really appropriate to use the indicator approach? No? First, are vulnerability indicators the right means to raise awareness on climate change? So if what you're doing, your end goal really is to raise people's awareness about climate change, then why use an indicator system? That's according to Hinkel, because he said it might not be fit if that is your end goal. Okay. Our vulnerability indicators, the right means to allocate adaptation funds to particular people, regions, and sectors. Yes, to a certain extent, but absolutely, in absolute terms, it cannot be so because there's a lot of politics that goes into adaptation funding, no, and funds for mitigation activities. No? Our vulnerability indicators, the right means to monitor adaptation policy. Again, his answer there is no, because there are a lot of other considerations and other factors and other elements that need to be considered when you're talking about monitoring as your purpose. No? And lastly, our vulnerability indicators, the right means to conduct scientific research. Again, the answer of Hinkel here, I thought he would say yes, no? But Hinkel said no, no, because there are a lot of other factors also that needs to come into the conduct of scientific research. At its best, no, what vulnerability indicators can do, no, is to serve as an entry point, no, to further detailed information that we need to come up with a deeper and larger picture of vulnerability of our unit, no, of analysis. No? So what it's saying is really there is merit when you do vulnerability assessment that makes use as an entry point a vulnerability indicator approach, no? But that it's also coupled by more qualitative, more participatory tools, no, for assessment. No? The different types of arguments used in developing indicators should be made transparent, especially the normative argument. And because things are dynamic, what Hinkel is also saying is that indicators will need to be updated regularly based on new research findings. So even if his answer to many of his questions is that there are a lot of things that we're doing where an indicator approach is not really fit, no? There is still room for vulnerability indicator and an index development, no? And there's always room for that because it needs to be updated. Okay. In terms of vulnerability assessment, some of the gaps, no, that coupled science and human security point of view, especially in the Philippines, and this is the challenge for our CCC, no? And for those who are doing vulnerability assessment for the CCC, I think Sirka is doing a new one, no? With the Lower Marikina. There's still very little empirical research in the country on the vulnerability of places, communities, economies, ecological systems, and so on and so forth to climate change. No? In my limited review of literature, there's a lot for the coastal and the fisheries sector, no? Both international and local, but a little about other hazards of place. No? The way we are localizing our strategy for climate change adaptation and climate change response in general, the national concept there is the ecotown. And the ecotown is anchored on a good vulnerability assessment. So my question was, is there a uniform vulnerability assessment approach that is being used? No? Uniform meaning to say the skeleton is there, it might change in terms of some other elements depending on where you're doing the assessment, what is and where is your location, no? Whether it's a coastal that would be different from an upland area. But then is there a overarching commonality also? And the question that I, the answer that I got is that there's a framework, a national framework, but it depends on the experts, how you're going to go about your vulnerability assessment. So there remains a gap to develop a common, perhaps, or a standard framework for the indicators of for vulnerability assessment. And there are a lot of other sectors that from the end of our decision makers need to be really looked into vulnerability, climate change vulnerability in terms of ecosystems. We have significant number of that in terms of coastal communities, coastal resources, forestry sector. But there's not much that we can dig in the literature regarding vulnerability of renewable energy sectors and what they refer to as climate smart industries, no? Which they're putting in into their agenda, but we don't have the studies to guide action and decisions. So I know it's as I've said earlier, it's really just scratching the surface, no? And there are a lot of work to be done. I have 200 reading materials in my database, and there's more. But we'll see how the next part of the paper will come out with the methodology. So, thank you.
Thank you very much, Prof. Emmy, for walking us through the different interpretations of vulnerability, approaches to vulnerability assessment and vulnerability research. So the floor is now open for your comments and questions. You may use the microphones along the aisle, so please. Yes, sir. Your name, sir, and the organization you are connected with?
Here.
Yes, it's okay.
Well, I'm retired, so I belong to the Senior Citizens Club. Now, I would like to have some observations and maybe later comments. Now, the Philippine representative of the climate change recently concluded a meeting elsewhere. Shamelessly cried in that forum by maintaining shamelessly.
The one in Warsaw, sir.
I think so. Yeah. Why? I think that is an expression that vulnerability is an exigent objective, not just, something to play around. He was expressing something that it is really very, it's an emerging thing. But if you look at the historical perspective of climate change, you have to go back to how it all started in the 1980s. It started as a socioeconomic discussion, really, after the end of the Cold War. When they found out that there was another type of war, and this is war against hunger. But the discussion of the socio-economic problem turned into more of a business, you know. So it turned out to say that there was more, that the problem really is related to climate change. Now, you were saying that we still have to develop some indicator. But the first and foremost indicator was the this was done in the Montreal Protocol. Ozone, that there was an increase in the ozone. Yes, that rather the ozone is being eroded. So that was the first basic indicator, 1987. Then the discussion ended, of course, with the promulgation of the idea of, you know, stopping the use of CFCs, the chlorofluorocarbon agents. Now, so it was followed in 1997. The Tokyo Protocol. And there, the another indicator came up. This is on the, you know, carbon monoxide, all these gases emitted by the engines. So that becomes a very real thing too. In fact, it came into an international policy. And the third one would be the Bali Protocol, 2007. You see, it is every 10 years. The flight about climate change is not really, it's like walking in the park. It's just a story. So what happened in the Bali Protocol? Of course, you know, this is the carbon trend, carbon trading, where the less developed countries were trying to put the blame on the developed countries. Now, I think that all started why we have to cry for it. It's not crying for because of the effect of it, it's crying for funds. So, I think if we consider this vulnerability to be an exigent factor, this whole presentation of yours can be really just presented into some kind of a game. One is like, you know, playing the lotto. You have all these variables. The very high end of expectations. You know, you is it right, and you get the prize. And the other one is change the game into the Russian roulette. And, you know, when there is a gun pointed in your head and say, okay, what's the most vulnerable. And I think from this big chunk of whatever you want to call it, database, you'd be forced to develop something like exigent solutions. Not look for other things. To explain the roulette, you have a good chance of, you know, living eternally or in your dream. So this is what I think about all these topics about climate change. I have a good perspective with it. I started learning with it. In fact, because I have a basic understanding of it, I started to work, you know, the old days. I started with in the YouTube micrometeorology we use daily. But that's besides the point. But I think right now, we cannot just simply isolate ourselves. For instance, what is the, people would like to think of the severity of a storm as something like a result of climate change. Perhaps it is not. Earthquake, you said it is not very, you cannot predict it. If you look at the data that's been published in the newspaper, that the most severe earthquake comes every 20 years. You know, meaning earthquakes beyond 7 point in Richter scale, of course, every 20 years. But this is not being played around, you know. There are some important things that we should know, because there's not a gun pointed in my head.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your comment, sir. We should be on our toes, according to Dr. De La Cruz, you know, when it comes to climate change. But comment, sir. When we talk about the depletion of our ozone layers and the GHG emission, when these are indicators of climate change. no? Which of course they are important, no? In the issue of vulnerability. Pero hindi po ako doon sa indicators lang ng climate variability. But then they have to be taken into consideration because scenarios have to be taken into.
Just one more. I think people started really in your presentation, it's either start with an end point and then the starting point. But the whole climate change really started with, you know, socio-economic problems affecting climate change. So I guess that's the point. Now we are going back really into that. It's all like a whole cycle. But there's so much fear in it, you know. And this fear has been translated into some kind of, you know, it's either policy or corruption.
Thank you very much. Are there any more questions? None? If there are none, let's give Professor Emmy another big round of applause. Thank you.